Bro, this manga has one of the best arcs I've seen in any manga, period. Bro, like I'm talking like brilliant art, check. Insanely high stakes, check. Creative mind games, check. Profound, check. And finally, cold as hell, check. Toshio Sako's 2006 gambling psychological thriller manga Usogui is the ultimate manifestation of crack. Now, like literally speaking, it's crazy, and I'll tell you why very shortly. So look bro, just to give you guys some context, right? I added this manga to my planning list in like 2020. I was planning to read it alongside Kingdom at the time, but then I was like, nah, forget it bro. Both are like long manga, I just couldn't be bothered doing that. So you already know like the hype is unreal. 3 years worth of hype, and it matched the hype, I'll tell you that. It definitely matched the hype. Usogui's story is about a crazy and what seems to be a reckless gambler with a mysterious past attached to a powerful underground organization called Kakerou, which defines as betting. In this world, we have the government and then we have Kakerou. This organization makes huge moves from the shadows, and it's involved with huge politicians, billionaires, and other powerful people who love to gamble. These guys gamble huge amounts of money, and sometimes even their life. Kakerou thrives off bets people make. The whole point of their organization is to essentially make every gamble as fair as possible. They bring the consequences upon the gamblers under any circumstances. If you win, they guarantee that the money will reach you safely. If you've lost your life in a bet, just remember you will not escape your death. And bro, the gamblers know that full and well. Despite that, they continue to put their life on the line in these death battles. Well, Usogui isn't just about death battles, but most of it is definitely just death games. You know, one thing I realize about MCs with a mysterious past, they often have insane character progression. For example, Gensoki, right? If you follow me on Instagram, you know that I finished Gensama last month, right? And it was incredible. As the story went on, we learned more and more about Gensoki's past, but when he started off in episode 3 of Gensama, he was very mysterious because he was alluding at an event that had already happened in his life. And in the same way, Sako was slowly revealing information about Baku that he had done a crazy gamble with a bunch of people in the past. That type of stuff is always really intriguing, and it is honestly the best way to pull in a new audience. But like, also when I saw that Baku has a mysterious past, like I knew bro was gonna be cold. Like I just knew it, you feel me? And cold he was, bro. Like he really was. When you get into the manga, you'll see what I mean, definitely. But yeah, one of the aspects that make him so cold is his destroyer characterization, and this will set up pretty much the entire sort of, I would say, thematic premise of Usogui. Throughout Usogui, we'll see Baku being shown as some sort of demon in a human body, or a person that just brings destruction to everyone around him. And there's even this one arc where we see a side character learning more about Baku from a Kakerou referee, who had even claimed that Baku gambled another human in order to survive. You see, we're building up onto the mystery of his character here. The referee then tells the side character to stay cautious of him. This characterization can be linked to A, the theme of perfection within Usogui, and B, the political aspect of Usogui. For example, when you read the Labyrinth arc, it'll really start expanding the politics and world of Usogui. That's when the world building really starts skyrocketing, and in Tower of Karma it'll really like, yeah, it'll take it to like a whole nother level. You'll notice the duality between chaos and order, right? It's explicitly stated within the manga, so if you don't notice that, like, I'm sorry, you might be just. Why is it that, you ask? It's a type of revolution and reform of society. Like destroying something and bringing it back up. That's kind of the concept of Baku here. And actually, one of Baku's motivations is to actually gamble someone's prestigious and powerful position in society so that he can bring about world peace. That's the way he goes about it within the Labyrinth arc. It just shows him taking down billionaires and whatnot. And we'll even see him doing this later in the manga and his backstory. And the other reason why Baku has this destroyer characterization is because of the main conflict of Usogui, which is imperfection versus perfection. Even the Labyrinth arc, which is about chaos and order, can be characterized as imperfect versus perfect. The bourgeoisie, who consider their economic class to be perfect, they deem their justice system and quote-unquote order they've placed in society to be perfect. Chaos is in the imperfection within this arc, and that's where Baku comes in. He is characterized as a destroyer because he breaks down things considered slash characterized to be perfect. He reveals the truth about him. After all, his nickname Usogui translates to the lie eater. So even that coldness has a few layers to it. Obviously, I can't go into more depth because of spoilers and stuff, but just know it gets expanded on as you go into the story. So listen, Usogui's main cast is also very underrated. Genuinely, no one talks about them, and some people just downright hate the cast. I think this is such a stupid take because, sure, the characters are very simplistic and straightforward. I think the personalities and respective presences are well developed and make for some really good cast chemistry, which is one of the most important aspects about just having a good cast. You'll notice this heavily when you reach an arc by the name of Proto Porus. One of the main characters in the story will remind you of Matahachi from Vagabond, but it's the Usogui version of that. And I'm keeping it real, bro, he's colder than Matahachi, bro. I'm sorry, I think he's a better character as well. Dude is so overhated, and for what, bro? His concept is basically trying to be equal with Madarame Baku, who's considered to be a legendary gambler, which again is linked to his mysterious past. And by the time we reach that final arc, that side character's development will be gas, trust me. You'll see him like analyzing all the gambles and everything, bro. It's actually amazing. Then we have another character that has another personality and side to him, which he has to fight to overcome. Basically, it's like two personalities fighting each other. This personality gives him more physical strength, but the character does not want him to lose himself to that strength. While the concepts of both characters aren't the most special or profound, they have their cold moments as well, trust me. Most of you will definitely grow to like them. Also, I do appreciate the thematic consistency of the cast as well. Both Baku and the cast are fighters against the concept of perfection with an Usogui and what it means to have a gamble. The main antagonists of Usogui are also great. They'll be symbols of perfection, and generally their character won't be of the highest quality, but what makes these antagonists really good is cleverly strategizing against a gambler who is considered to be first legendary and secondly a manipulative mastermind. I think people severely underestimate how significant well-made fights and psychological mind games can be. Unlike other series, Usogui has almost little to no plot armor within it. Everything is justified through a post hoc explanation with clear and blatant foreshadowing. Like, bro, you'll notice the foreshadowing. You'll definitely notice the foreshadowing. You'll be like, yeah, that's definitely something he's going to use in the future. But then you won't be able to guess how he's going to use that. And even the antagonists have this as well. Like, you won't be able to guess, like, how they're going to act in the future. It's like Death Note, bro. Both L and Light kept outsmarting each other, and it just infinitely rose the tension within the series. This is practically the antagonist cast summarized. But there's actually one antagonist that stands above all. In fact, a lot of people like him more than the protagonist himself. And I'm talking about Kiruma Soichi, the leader of Kakerou. Arguably one of the best constructed characters I have ever seen, alongside Baku. His presence is heavy and mesmerizing. Yeah. I said I feel invisible. It's 100 in a spot. I won't keep going. It's 85 just to walk. Like, bro, he is Destroy Lonely, he is opium, okay? And in fact, to make it even better, he is a top 10 antagonist for me all time. The main conflict of his character is also the concept of perfection, but also personal desire versus the larger fate given to him. The way those themes manifest through his various identities is exactly what makes for a great antagonist. There's a part of him with human desires, but then there's also a part of him put into the position of the leader of Kakerou. I mean, his name Soichi, right? The soul part of his name literally translates to create. It creates a nice power dynamic with Baku, who destroys forms and society, while the other is creating something. Creating identities, creating a new form and a new society. That's his form of revolution. While I won't tell you what specific relationship he has with Baku, it's a very unique and interesting one. Because on top of those identities, he also has memory issues, so things get very weird and complex, but you'll get through it. Another unique aspect to Soichi is the whole Rubik's Cube symbolism. Like, firstly, it just makes his character more memorable visually, right? And it sets up a more, and I'm not even trying to be corny, right, but like weird and sophisticated tone to his character. Like, out of every symbol you could have picked, you picked a Rubik's Cube, but at the same time, it's like, yeah, this guy's sophisticated, this guy's smart, you know? And at the same time, the Rubik's Cube is the ultimate symbol of, firstly, mind game, but secondly, imperfection versus perfection. When the cube is all jumbled and messed up, it's imperfect. When the cube is complete with all the colors stacked up with each other, it's perfect. That's imperfection versus perfection. And I think the symbol kind of interestingly plays into Baku's ideology as well. That ideal forms don't last forever. Like, when you finish solving your Rubik's Cube, what is the first thing you do right after that? You jumble it up and you do it again. Ideal forms don't last forever. Ideal form in this case being the complete Rubik's Cube. And there's also this sort of parasite symbolism, I would say. I'm not sure what that entails, but for me, I felt like it's as if the position of the leader was kind of imposed onto Soichi through his heretical bloodline, making the position of the leader sort of like a parasite. Now that we've talked about the characters of Usogui, I want to talk about the narrative. And there's something I want you to pay attention to when you read Usogui. And that is the Hangman arc. The recontextualization to this arc is nasty, bro. It's crazy. trust me. On Ethiopia, bro, like when you reread this arc after finishing Usogui, you'll get goosebumps. In fact, you don't even need to reread it, just download the right panels. Like, you'll be able to tell which panels are going to be used in the future. I mean, firstly, even before the Labyrinth and the Tower of Karma arc, it sets up the dynamic between Soichi and Baku. It begins Soichi's alien characterization, which directly links to a future moment in the series. And ultimately, there's a panel in this arc which directly links back to the conclusion of the series, which links the fear, fate, and carving your own fate and other aspects to the series. So definitely don't miss out on important foreshadows in the arc. I appreciate how Sako tries to give every arc in Usogui a larger purpose. Very nice. By the way, I want to touch up on fate for a second. It's just the way fate is explored within Usogui is so unique, because it's like we have the premise of gambling here, and then you create the dynamic between Soichi and Baku. You know, I'm not sure how to say this, but it's like the things that fate implied within the series, like fear, imperfection, is all simultaneously kind of exploring the idea anyways. That's why you won't see me really mentioning fate explicitly too much within this video, because it's a given, right? This isn't like an analytical breakdown of Usogui, but rather like a holistic overview of what the themes are within Usogui. Okay, bro, we gotta talk about the art, though. Like, we've talked enough about that nerdy, corny stuff, bro. Like, we don't need to hear more about that. So listen, bro, Usogui is one of the best artistic endeavors of all time, period. Like, sure, bro, it's very flawed, and I'll actually be talking about the flaws soon, but it's still amazing. First and foremost, you can conceptually see how passionate Sako was about drawing, but secondly, how crazy and menacing his art actually is. It's one of the main reasons why this manga is just so intense and exhilarating. It's like JoJo outsmarting reactions on crack. You know, it's like one player does something and then the other guy reacts, and it's just that crazy face. Basically, the manga gets you addicted to those facial expressions, and you're just unable to put down the manga. You're like, what is this guy gonna react next? What face is this guy gonna make next? But alongside that, Sako's compositioning is just immensely creative. For example, in the first arc, in order to introduce Baku's light eater concept, he literally puts the viewpoint slash camera inside of a mouth. Like, bro, who thinks of that? Who thinks of that? Like, it's just repeated panels that are so creative like that, which make the art just amazing. And then later on, after chapter 200, he's developed amazing drawing skills and whatnot. His artistic concepts have always been amazing, but now he has the ability to like execute that concept on a whole nother level that we haven't seen before. Air Poker, for example, the second to last arc of Usogui. Lord have mercy on my soul, bro. Lord have mercy on my soul, bro. Like, you will genuinely feel as if you're levitating on air while reading that art. Genuinely, like, I'm not joking. You'll be in water, submerged, you feel me? Bro, to even, like, increase the experience for me, I turned on, you know, water sounds? Just search up, like, water ambient sounds, and then I just read the arc. It was insane. It was insane, genuinely. And you know what strikes me the most is that he was doing this weekly, bro. He was slaving himself away to the art, bro. Come on. So far, all I've had of Usogui is praise, but it is a truly, truly flawed series. And let me explain. To give all the new fans some context, a lot of people find the first 300 chapters of Usogui to be mid, if not bad at some points. I actually disagree with them. I don't think it's that boring, but it definitely isn't of the highest quality. This is because of one major reason. It's hard to follow along. Whether that's the paneling or the game rules, it's just hard to follow along because Sako's concepts are always amazing and creative. It's just at this point in time, he doesn't have the artistic or narrative ability to execute those ideas well. And I said before that the art starts picking up after chapter 200. What I meant by that is that the art before, yeah, it's still pretty good, but it's very inconsistent, I would say. And after that 200 chapter mark, I would say the art just skyrockets. But that's just line art and sort of big spreads. In terms of panel flow, I think it actually starts picking up near the second half of Labyrinth. Not only are the games much easier to understand, but the panel flow, the fights, all of them are just so easy to read. It really flows nicely, and that's when Usogui really starts getting addicting. It's like, you cannot put this down. You'll be reading a fight, and there'll be a panel, you'll be following the fight, and they'll do a certain move, right? It will be as if you skipped 10 seconds into the future. It's like, what were the moves that were happening in between that time frame? You know what I'm saying? It's very hard to follow. When you keep reading it again and again and again, then you'll understand like what Sako's trying to do. And yeah, sure, it'll give you like a really satisfying feeling when it just clicks in your brain, right? But it just doesn't weigh up, you feel me? Like, the flaws don't outweigh the sort of satisfaction you get from understanding it. I think another flaw that people have is sort of the scanned quality of Usogui can be pretty shabby. I don't think it's too bad though. I think people are just complaining a bit too much on that. But yeah, I thought it was fine personally, but there's a possibility that you guys might dislike the scan quality. So we've discussed the introduction, body, now all that's left is the conclusion. The conclusion is phenomenal. Trust me, you will not be able to predict it. Despite all of the meta characterization for Baku and the arc name surpassing the leader, you will not be able to guess how their arc's conclusion, aka the entire series conclusion, plays out. It will be the single most insane you would have ever read. And honestly, it's perfect outside of the maybe bit more needed exploration on the whole societal conflict that Baku and Soichi had going on in Tower of Karma. But yeah, it's sort of the idea that life is a gamble, right? We don't know what's coming next, right? Which refers to death, as suggested by the consistent appearance of death games in the series. Humans truly shine in the gamble of life knowing that death approaches. And there's more layers to this, it's just that it'll be like a huge spoiler, like I can't talk about it. But yeah, and finally man, it's time for a rating. In future videos, hopefully we can do ratings and rankings at the same time. Right now there's a ranking issue going on with my list, I can't really reveal what that is. So yeah, I think I'm gonna give Usogui a... Okay, you know what? Wait a second. This might sound weird, right? But like the flawed nature of Usogui kind of rhythmically pairs with the whole imperfect versus perfect narrative that is Usogui. But for now, I'm going to give this manga a plain... well, anyways, thanks for watching the video, guys. Alright, I'm joking. I'm going to give this manga a plain 10 out of 10. Simple as that. 10 doesn't really equate to perfect or flawless as a series, but rather a favorite of mine and something that really truly... touched my heart. Anyways, thank you so much for watching this video. Hopefully I've convinced you to read Usogui, and I'll see you guys in the next video.